you're likely aware, in response to our growing and changing county from a population of 20,000 in 1920 to more than 420,000 today, we opened our North Tower in April of 2020, sadly in the midst of the pandemic. Some notable features of the tower include all private rooms with high-tech amenities, an expanded level 3 neonatal intensive care unit, or NICU, the highest level in Loudoun County, new labor and delivery and postpartum care units, an OB emergency room, and a new cardiac and pulmonary rehabilitation center. Despite the impressiveness of the services we currently offer, we are not resting on our laurels. In the near future, we will begin offering interventional pulmonology and thoracic surgery services. I had to practice that one. And just since May, we have received numerous recognitions, including U.S. News and World Report named us a top hospital for 2021 and 22, and they nationally ranked us in neurosurgery and neurology. We received the American College of Cardiology's Chest Pain MI Registry Platinum Performance Achievement Award. The American Association of Critical Care Nurses recognized the excellence of our intensive care unit with the Beacon Award. And the Inova Wirtz Miller Family Hospital and Trauma Center and Inova Loudoun Hospital Cornwall Wheeler Family Emergency Department each received the Emergency Nurses Association Lantern Award. Of note, only 33 emergency departments across the United States have been named recipients of this award. In closing, Inova Loudoun Hospital continues to be proud to be part of the Loudoun community. And as Helen Keller is credited with saying, alone we can do so little, together we can do so much. Thank you.
Thank you, Dory. Next, I'd like to introduce our spotlight sponsor for today's event, Novec. It is my pleasure to introduce Lisa Weber, Novec's Vice President of Public Relations, staged by a few brief remarks.
Good morning, everyone. It's nice to see all of you in person. Such a treat, isn't it? Novec is again proud to be the spotlight sponsor of today's Attorney General debate. It's been quite a year since last we gathered, hasn't it? Again, it's just nice to see all of you. If COVID-19 demonstrated anything, it's that electricity touches all of our lives in just about every way imaginable. In Loudoun County, Novec provides electric service to more than 42,000 individual residences, small businesses, big companies with household names, and everything in between. When everyone was spending more time at home, Novec had a central role in powering online teleconferences, remote classroom instruction, and virtual visits that kept families and friends connected. Through it all, our employees' resilient spirit kept Novec's offices open for business every single day. Thankfully, we've resumed more normal operations and continue to adapt. That's likely the case for many of your businesses as well. For 22 consecutive years, Novec has had the distinction and honor of being the most reliable electric utility in metropolitan Washington, D.C. That achievement is not marked by our determination, but by an industry standard. In 2020, the average Novec customer was without electricity for only about 1 hour. That's half of the national average. Such a remarkable reliability record is largely attributable to Novec's skilled and dedicated employees. Our investment in technology, major system upgrades, and miles of new electric line are in place to handle growing electric loads across our service territory. But here in Loudoun County, as you well know, you are bursting with new business growth. Novec appreciates this opportunity to welcome all of you to today's debate. Our civic duty extends beyond voting. It also includes being knowledgeable about the candidates and their positions on the issues. And for that, Novec thanks the Loudoun County Chamber for hosting this Attorney General debate so that all of us are better informed when we go to the polls on November 2nd. Thank you.
hand off to our moderator for this debate, the president and CEO of the Loudoun Chamber, Tony Howard, to introduce our panel and candidates for today's debate. Please welcome Tony to the stage.
Okay, thank you so much, Kirsten. Thank you as well to Dory and the Loudoun Hospital, as well as to Lisa. And Novak, our sponsors, and all of our sponsors for this morning's debate. Indeed, my name is Tony Howard. I am your president of the Loudoun Chamber of Commerce, and it's my great pleasure to welcome you to the 2021 Virginia Attorney General Candidates Debate. So I'm going to begin this morning by offering a quick overview of the rules for today's debate. Now, these rules have been negotiated with and decided by and agreed to by both the Herring and the Orange campaigns. To begin with, each candidate will have the opportunity to offer a two-minute opening and a two-minute closing statement. The candidates will take turns responding to each question. They will have 2 minutes to respond to the question directed to them at their turn. The other candidate will then have 2 minutes themselves to respond to that very same question. And then the candidate that answers first will have a 30-second rebuttal of the time. The order in which the candidates will offer their statements in response to our questions was determined in advance through a random drawing by the Loudoun County Chamber staff. A Loudoun Chamber staff member will serve as a timekeeper. A yellow card will be raised to indicate that the candidates have 30 seconds to finish their response. A red card will be raised when time has expired. Candidates, at that point, I'm going to ask you to complete the sentence that you are offering at that time and then conclude your response. The order in which the candidates will be asked questions will alternate until the time allotted for the questions expires, at which time the closing statements will begin. Now, candidates will not be allowed to question one another. As moderator, it is within my discretion to redirect a candidate on their response to ask a follow-up question if I feel the candidate has not specifically addressed the question posed to them. Now, the candidates are only permitted to offer spoken responses to our questions. They may not bring or use any charts, pictures, graphs, or other visual displays to the dais. They have been provided with a pen and paper to take notes from the podium during the debate. As a reminder, all the questions in today's debate are business-focused, and none of them were shared with the candidates in advance. Now, just a friendly reminder for our audience, please refrain from any loud, sustained, or otherwise disruptive behavior that would interfere with the candidate's ability to respond to the questions. Now, I ask you this courtesy out of respect for both the candidates, but also your fellow audience members who are here today to listen to the candidates and have them express their vision for how they would serve the Commonwealth as our executive attorney general. I thank you for your understanding and, of course, your cooperation. All right, let's get at it. It's now my great pleasure to introduce our panel of business leaders who will question our candidates this morning. I'd like to begin by introducing Mr. Siobhan McFadden. Siobhan is the principal of the Quinson Wealth Strategy. He is also the vice chairman of the Loudoun County Economic Development Authority. Welcome, Siobhan. Next up, I am very pleased to introduce, reintroduce Stacy Metcalf. She is the executive director and CEO at Marvin Park, and she is your 2021, as well as our 2020, chair of the board of the Loudoun County Board of Directors. Welcome, Stacy. And another reintroduction, Dory O'Brien. Dory is the director of Western Regional Government and Community Relations with Inova Health Systems. Welcome, Dory, again. Thank you for joining us. Let me introduce Emma Roy. She is our timekeeper for this morning. Attorney General Mark Herring. Attorney General, you can take the stage in front of you, please. Now, in 2013, Mark Herring became the first Democrat to win election as Virginia's Attorney General in more than 20 years. 4 years later, he became the first Attorney General to be re-elected in nearly 30. Now, prior to his current position, General Herring served as state senator for Loudoun County. He was a member of the Loudoun County Board of Supervisors, and he served as an attorney in private practice in his hometown of Leesburg. General Herring received a bachelor's and a master's degree from the University of Virginia before attending the University of Richmond School of Law. He and his wife, Laura, have been married for more than 30 years. They have two children, daughter Peyton and son, Tim. Ladies and gentlemen, please welcome Attorney General Mark Herring. Now I'd like to introduce his challenger, Republican nominee for the Attorney General of Virginia, Delegate Jason Meehan. widest margin in the district's history, while becoming the first Cuban American ever elected to Virginia General Assembly. Prior to being elected, he served as prosecutor and assistant commonwealth's attorney for the city of Virginia Beach, and was a founding member of the Virginia Hispanic Chamber of Commerce. Delegate Yaris received his bachelor's degree from James Madison University before attending the College of William & Mary School of Law. He currently resides in Virginia Beach with his wife, Paige, three daughters, and a golden retriever named Buckley. Ladies and gentlemen, please, again, welcome Delegate Jason Yaris. You are welcome. In terms of the rules of the debate, we will begin with an opening statement. Delegate Yaris, you've chosen to go first.
Well, I appreciate being here. Thank you for the Loudoun Chamber of Commerce. As mentioned, I represent Virginia Beach in the House of Delegates. I was a prosecutor in Virginia Beach as well. But for you to know where I want to go as Attorney General, it's important for you to know a little bit where I came from. I like to say my story in many ways doesn't begin in Virginia Beach, Virginia. It actually begins in a bay in Cuba when a scared 19-year-old girl got an airplane, penniless and homeless, and not knowing where her next meal was going to come from. And that was my mother, Miriam Yaris. And I was raised every day to appreciate the fact that I was able to breathe the air as a free person in this remarkable, amazing country. And that this nation has given more second chances to more people from more backgrounds than any country in the history of the world. So first of all, if your family came to this country seeking hope and opportunity, there's a good chance your family is a lot like my family. It'd be the biggest honor of my life to be your attorney general. My mother fled Cuba on October of 1965, actually October 11th. Anniversary was just 2 days ago. And almost 50 years to the day that she left, she was able to go in the voting booth and get a ballot and vote for me to represent her in the oldest democracy in the Western Hemisphere, the Virginia House of Delegates. That's what I call the American miracle. But one of the things that makes the American miracle possible is when people like my mother come here, they're not looking over their shoulder in fear. But when I talk to voters every day, Republicans, Democrats, and Independents, that's what they see. They turn on the nightly news and they know something is off. Our murder rate is the highest it's been in Virginia in decades. We have a criminal first, victim last mindset that has come forth in Richmond by one party rule. I think we need a check and balance. And we have a parole that has let out murderers, cop killers, and rapists out early, sometimes with decades on their sentence. And we've seen some of those individuals that commit additional felonies. That makes no sense. We need a check and balance in Richmond. As Attorney General, I'll be that check and I'll be that balance. Mark Herring has failed being that check and balance, and that's the role I'll serve as your next Attorney General.
Thank you, Delegate Harris. Attorney General Herring, it's your turn.
In this election for Attorney General, voters will choose between my proven record of protecting Virginians and expanding our rights, and Jason Miares, whose record shows he is a right-wing, Cuccinelli-style conservative who would abuse the office and undermine both our safety and our rights. He has based his entire campaign on one issue, the parole board, but time and again, he's been called out for getting the facts wrong and misleading voters by independent fact-checkers and reporters. And he's gone out of his way to avoid saying what the job really is and what he would do. And let's talk about that. I've worked to get new gun safety laws passed and defended them in court when the gun lobby challenged them. Jason loves to tout his NRA endorsement and has pledged not to even enforce our gun safety laws. I won a landmark case for marriage equality that's now the law of the land, and Jason is opposed to LGBT rights. Still, even in 2021, he voted against marriage equality and protections against discrimination. I believe women have the right to make their own decisions about their reproductive health, and I've gone to court to protect it. Jason is opposed to a woman's right to choose and would go to court to overturn Roe versus Wade, and he would overturn Roe versus Wade and ban abortion. Now, that's just the tip of the iceberg. The choice is clear and the stakes are high. I have proven that I will always work to keep Virginia a safer, more prosperous, and more inclusive place. Jason has proven he is a conservative activist with a paper-thin record as a prosecutor who has no problem misleading voters, and Virginians can't afford that. We need to continue to build on our progress and keep Virginia moving forward.
Thank you, General Herring. Okay. Our first question from our panel will be offered by Mr. McFadden, and it will be directed first to Delegate Yaris.
Delegate Yaris, in your opinion, what is
government breaking the law, actually, if need be, taking them to court. Instead, he stepped back and said, this is not my responsibility. Well, five former attorney generals disagree. The former head of the parole board disagrees and said, you had a responsibility. You failed with that job, Attorney General Herring. I would not.
Thank you, Delegate Herring. Delegate Yaris, Attorney General Herring, please.
The Attorney General is the people's lawyer, and I believe the Attorney General should be using the law as a way to help people, to help our fellow Virginians, especially those who are vulnerable, those who are discriminated against, those who truly need the arm and shield of the law to help and protect them. And that's why I've gone to court to protect people's rights, whether it was a landmark case on marriage equality, whether it was to protect health care from legal attack. And you know, Jason keeps wanting to talk about the parole board, even though he's been called out time and again for misleading voters and getting the facts wrong. And those five previous attorney generals were all Republicans circling the wagons because he knows he's been called out for misleading voters. Now, the truth is, he doesn't want to talk about what the attorney general is really about. He doesn't want to talk about it because he knows that when voters find out, they will drive him away. He is opposed to the Affordable Care Act. He voted against the Medicaid expansion that has given health care hundreds of thousands of people in Virginia. He is opposed to a woman's right to choose and would use the office to overturn Roe versus Wade and ban abortion. He is opposed to our gun safety laws and thinks that we need more guns everywhere. He's even is out of sync with where Virginians are on issue after issue, and I will stack my public safety record against anyone's anytime. My team and I have worked to keep sexual violent predators out of our communities. My team has, we have interrupted major narcotics trafficking. We've done over 150, or almost 150, narcotics cases involving heroin and fentanyl, taking over 750 pounds of heroin off the street. I've created a human trafficking task force that's now becoming a national model for bringing perpetrators to justice and rescuing victims. I've worked with dozens of law enforcement agencies across the state to help provide new tools for domestic violence and prevent homicide. So I believe the Attorney General is the people's lawyer, and I have a proven record of keeping Virginians safe and protecting our rights.
Thank you, General Herring. Our next question will come from Stacey Metcalf, and she will direct it first towards Attorney General Herring.
Don't I get 30 seconds to respond?
My apologies, sir, you did.
I mean, he says he's the people's lawyer, but part of the people's lawyers is actually standing up for victims, and that's not standing up for victims. And just on September 21st, William Hughes, the former chairman of the parole board, said, you failed at your job. Your job is to hold agencies accountable when they're not doing theirs. You failed, you stood silent. What's even worse is when there finally was an investigation of this by the inspector general, you had an attorney in charge of averting threats do nothing. Instead of the public finding out with one of the worst scandals we've seen in decades in Virginia, you know what they did? They issued a heavily redacted report and blocked out all the names. Why don't you actually come clean, release the report, and actually have some sunlight on what is one of the worst scandals
in Virginia? Thank you, Delegate. Appreciate that. All right, now we move on to our second question. Stacey, please, you're up.
Good morning, Attorney General Herring. One of the duties of the Office of Attorney General is to defend Commonwealth's laws and policies when challenged in court. As Attorney General, what criteria would you use to decide which laws and actions to defend and how to defend them?
Well, first of all, it's important to make sure that the laws that are passed are in fact constitutional, and when they're challenged, the Attorney General has an important decision to make about what to do. Now, when I was confronted with that, within the first couple of weeks of my term, I saw that the ban on marriage for same-sex couples was unconstitutional. And so I went into court and I fought for marriage equality. And we won a landmark case. And it has meant so much to so many Virginians. They called me in tears, telling me what it meant to them that their Attorney General was standing up and fighting for them, rather than to defend an unconstitutional ban on marriage for same-sex couples. Now, my opponent, as recently as this year, voted against marriage equality. He voted against protections for our LGBTQ community. And that is just out of sync with where Virginians are and shows he is unable to embrace Virginia of today. And it has helped to make Virginia a place that is open and welcoming to everyone. But Virginia has been named the best state in America for business. And a lot of the reason for that is because we have become the state that is known for being open and welcoming to everyone, and companies want to locate in a place like that because they know their employees are going to be respected and that they will feel it, that they are a full part of their community. Now, my opponent, Jason, says he won't even enforce our gun safety measures, even though they're legal, they're constitutional, and you know, that's not the kind of attorney general we need. We need an attorney general like me who will stand up and fight for Virginians and make sure that we are on the right side of the law and the right side of history. And it has made such a difference for so many Virginians, and they have told me it has literally changed their lives for the better.
Thank you, Gentleman Herring. Delegate Bierar, your response. Listen, the day that I take office, I'm going to take an oath of allegiance to both follow the United States Constitution, the Virginia Constitution, and to follow and execute the laws of Virginia. It's not my job to supersede the judgment of the General Assembly and the governor. I'm not going to be loyal to any political party. I'm going to be loyal to the people of Virginia. That's very different than Attorney General Herring, who has put everything to the partisan left-wing lens that have now captured, quite frankly, his own party. On issues like photo ID, which is broadly supported by the public, he decided just going to arbitrarily not defend the law, even though even the last poll I saw, the majority of Democrats supported the idea of photo ID. Because at the end of the day, that's what protects election integrity as well. And so what does that mean for you? It means that it was a law that was passed by the General Assembly and signed by the governor, was actually defended by outside counsel, hundreds of thousands of dollars paid for by outside counsel. That's hundreds of thousands of dollars they've gone to your kids' school or the roads in your community or the police officers as well. And so I'm going to call balls and strikes. That's my pledge to you as Attorney General. I think both parties at times have been guilty, but definitely the last 8 years, you've seen everything in this office has been done by this left-wing ideology that has taken over that office as well. And listen, at the end of the day, we talk about following laws. Some of that is actually making sure state agencies follow the law. And we've seen this parole board time and time again break the law. And what did Attorney General Mark Herring do? He did stood by and did nothing, and he stood silent. I will never stay silent in that situation. I would actually speak up of the one group that sometimes is so often ignored in Richmond, the victims. I'll always have the back of the victims. Unfortunately, Mark Herring doesn't.
Okay, thank you, Delegate Muirs. Attorney General Herring, you have 30 seconds of your rebuttal, please.
Well, the stakes are really high. So many of the issues that are so important, gun safety laws, a woman's right to choose, health care, even vaccination policies, all of these are being fought out in court, and it's going to fall to the Attorney General to say where Virginia stands on these and to fight And there are stark differences between us on both of those. First of all, on keeping, on protecting and expanding our rights, I have a proven record of going into court in both the state and federal level of making sure that people's health care is protected. You know, I will never forget sitting around a table listening to breast cancer survivors worry about what would happen if Republican AGs were successful in taking the Affordable Care Act away from them and the pre-existing conditions that are protected. They didn't know what they would do, and thankfully, we won in the Supreme Court not once, but twice. I've also gone to protect a woman's right to choose because I know how important it is for women to be able to make their own health care decisions. Jason would devote resources to taking away those rights. I've gone to court to protect our LGBTQ community. I've gone to court and won time after time to remove symbols of Confederate propaganda because that's a distortion of our history and has been a huge weight on Black Virginians that needed to be removed. Jason is opposed to removing those symbols of white supremacy. He would fight to take away health care. He would take away a woman's right to choose, and we can't have that in Virginia. And on public safety, my team and I have worked tirelessly to keep Virginians safe. And we have removed sexual violent predators out of our communities. We have successfully interrupted major narcotics trafficking rings. We have put extra resources to go after perpetrators of child abuse because nothing could be more important than protecting our children. That's how I would balance it, making sure that we are keeping Virginians safe and protecting and expanding our rights.
Thank you, General Kyrie. Delegate Mayors, you have 30 seconds for a rebuttal.
Well, so there's only one candidate on this stage who failed to do their job, and a lot of state agencies break the law, and that's Mark Herring. And he stood by and did nothing. And when you talk about law enforcement, I'm proud of the fact that the Police Benevolent Association, which actually endorsed you 8 years ago, Mark, has endorsed me. I'm proud of the fact that I received the endorsement of the Fraternal Order of Police. I'm proud of the fact that I have Republican, Independent, and Democrat sheriffs from across the Commonwealth that has endorsed me. As Sheriff Shuler and Smith County noted, I didn't leave the Democratic Party. It left me by these anti-police tactics and anti-police rhetoric that is hurting and making Virginians less safe. He bragged about his record of murder rates the highest it's been in two decades. That's not a record.
Thank you very much, Delegate Harris. Moving on to our next question, if you will, and Siobhan McFadden will ask this, and he will direct it towards Attorney General Harry.
Attorney General Harris, what role does the Attorney General's office play in ensuring Virginia has a strong and stable economy, and how would you work to protect the interests of businesses and other job creators?
Well, the Attorney General has some very important roles, and let me start off by saying it's really good to be talking with you all as business leaders. I, as you know, used to be a member of this very chamber, when I was in private practice, owned my own firm or was in partnership with others, and many of my clients were drawn from the business and professional community. So, you know, that knowledge and experience helps inform how I can help businesses thrive as Attorney General. And one of the ways that we have really made sure that Virginia is a place that, you know, I would say is the best state in America for to live, to work, to raise a family, and to start and grow a business in, is to make sure that we are a place that is open and welcoming to everyone. And that started right at the very beginning when I walked into court and went in and fought for marriage equality, making sure that everyone felt welcome and a part of their community. It means standing up and protecting for women's reproductive rights. It means making sure that we're not perpetuating distortions of history with lost cause propaganda on public places. You know, all of these things are really important to making a business climate that businesses want to grow and expand in, and the businesses want to move to. So that is a huge part of why Virginia was named best state in America for business back to back. And we need to continue that approach to make sure that we're continuing to do that. And I've also provided a consistent, steady interpretation of laws because that's what businesses want. And I know that from my experience. They want laws that they can follow, regulations that are clear and as simple and
literally has a division in his attorney general's office funded by an outside liberal special interest group. And you know what their job is? Their job is to go after Virginia businesses. That's their job. That's the difference between the two of us. I'm proud to have the endorsement of the NFIB. At the end of the day, we're 49th in the country right now in new business startups. 40,000 net new jobs the last 8 years in Virginia. 40,000. You want to know what North Carolina was? 400,000. Just last week, Ford Motor Company announced they're building 3 new plants. None in Virginia. One in Tennessee, one in Kentucky, one in the Carolinas. They bypassed Virginia. Why? Because right to work is on the ballot this fall. And if it wasn't, why would are the unions funding Mark Herring's campaign? And by the way, he's against the right to work amendment. I understand the repeal right to work would be the greatest job-creating engine for the state of North Carolina they've ever seen. But it would cripple our business and our ability to attract new businesses to Virginia. I can guarantee when you talk to Amazon HQ and others, right to work is critically important for them. Project labor agreements, something that my opponent absolutely 100% support, I oppose. Because a private sector employee, we should let the free market make these determinations. And listen, my mother was a member of a union, but no one should be forced to join a union in order to be able to keep their job. That's Mark Herring's view of the economy. I would enable you to be able to thrive, hire, and say you're hired to more and more people every day. That's my job, and that's going to be my role as a judge.
Thank you so much, Delegate. General Herring, you have 30 seconds for a rebuttal.
I am a pro-business, pro-opportunity attorney general. And every single day, my team and I work to build safe, successful communities all across the state. And I'm glad Jason brought up Amazon. Do you think Amazon would have come to a state that wasn't open and welcoming to everyone, that tried to further marginalize LGBTQ Virginians, that tried to take away a woman's right to choose, that would perpetuate lost cause propaganda, that wouldn't even enforce our gun safety laws? No. The kind of business climate that we've set is one that attracts business and helps it grow.
Thank you, General Herring. Okay, our next question will come from Stacey Metcalf, and she will direct it towards Delegate Niarz.
Good morning, Delegate Niarz. The Office of Attorney General works closely with law enforcement to combat cyber threats and promote secure and safe communities. How will you work to protect small business from current and future cybercrime and ransomware attacks?
Listen, I just got briefed on this week. The number of attacks right now happening in Virginia is exponential. And it's shocking. And what's crazy is the non-state actors. We just saw a $6 million ransom that got paid earlier this year on the pipeline. And that now means non-state actors have 6 million reasons to attack our infrastructure. And they are. And it's actually quite sobering where we're at. The realm of cyber warfare is only going to get more and more aggressive. So one of the first things I would do is set up a special task force in the AG's office to make sure, one, our electric grid, our power grid is absolutely secure, because that would be one of the most critical, devastating impacts we'd ever have that would ever impact our country. I think as well, I just recognize within that office that it means that you're working with law enforcement and business. And whenever there's a data breach, this is what I hear from so many businesses, they've been victim of a crime. They themselves are victim of a felony. But too often we see liberal attorney generals from around the country that when somebody's the victim of a data breach, even though they're the victim of a data breach, they're treated like they're the criminal. The reality is they're not. They've been the victim of a crime. So I believe in being collaborative. I want to sit down with these different companies and say, listen, let's first of all make sure this doesn't happen again. But recognize that you've been the victim of multiple felonies or something that a data breach, and find a way to make sure that your data is absolutely secure. I think that's a very, very different mindset. I think too often when you talk to different companies, they feel like liberal attorney generals like Mark Herring, they just treat like a political football. That when they have a problem, then the first time they find out about it is when they read about it in the paper or there's a press release. The reality is I'd rather work with the companies and say, listen, I recognize you've been the victim of a crime. I recognize this is devastating for you and your employees. And I want to work with you, not against you, to make sure this never, ever, ever happens again. That's going to be my goal and my role as attorney general. Collaborative. Not attacking.
Thank you, Delegate. Attorney General, apparently you have 2 minutes to respond.
So we work closely with both law enforcement and business on cyber crimes in a number of different ways. And one is to try to make sure that businesses have the tools that they need to help try to guard against those types of attacks. And it's also really important to recognize that that it's important to make sure that they are doing everything they can to protect the data, because all of us have an interest in making sure that personal information that is stored on vast systems is safe and is protected. Otherwise, so many people can become the victim of identity theft and other ways. We also have another part of our computer crimes unit that goes after predators who would prey on our children. And we work really proactively to help inform parents about how they can protect their children from online abuse. And we do it in a lot of different ways. And we have also invested in new technology to help protect children and making sure that we're doing everything we can to help rescue them when they are abused. So there are a lot of elements to the computer crimes, but a big part of it is also working with our federal partners, our federal law enforcement partners, because oftentimes the perpetrators of these cyber crimes, they're not in Virginia, they may not even be in our country, they may be halfway around the world. And it's really going to be important to have an attorney general like me who continues to work productively and cooperatively with our federal law enforcement officers to ensure that our businesses are as protected as possible and that our children are as safe as possible.
Very good. Thank you so much. Delegate Mayors, you have 30 seconds.
I'm glad you talked about predators. You know who else is a predator? David Simpkins. David Simpkins had 56 prior felony convictions, including 14 prior armed robberies, forcible sodomy, and abduction. He was supposed to be in the prison until the year 2066. You know what happened? He got out 46 years early. You know what he did with his 56th chance to get his life straight? He committed his 57th felony. He walked into a convenience store, put on a mask, held a gun up to the head of a young clerk. As the prosecutor noted in that case, David Simpkins should have never, ever been in a position to harm anyone in our community ever again. But he was, by this very parole board that Mark Caron will hold accountable.
Thank you so much, Delegate. Okay, our next question will come from Dory O'Brien. She will direct it towards Attorney General Herron.
Attorney General Herron, in considering whether Virginia should enter into a multi-state legal action against a private business or industry, what criteria or circumstances are most critical to your decision?
So, as Attorneys General, we very often work together on large investigations that involve companies that are national or global in nature, and there are serious allegations of harm or criminal activity or other violations of law. So the criteria I use is really, first of all, what law may have been broken, and also what's the harm to Virginians. And where a company has violated law and harmed Virginians, then I'm going to want to do everything I can to help make Virginians whole and make sure that they are protected, not just from the one incident that they may have experienced, but that going forward that they're protected and kept safe. And so that's why I have continued to work productively with my Attorney General colleagues. I do think that, you know, while sometimes there are occasions when issues between Attorneys General among Democrats and Republicans fall along predictable partisan lines, very often the work we do across party lines, and we work very well together. So things like consumer protection, antitrust issues, or things like the opioid epidemic, you know, those are areas where we've worked really well all across the board. And the opioid epidemic is one that has really touched the lives of so many families here in Virginia and across the country, and that's why I made it a special point to hold the pharmaceutical companies accountable for creating and perpetuating the opioid epidemic. And it has meant so much to those who have lost loved ones to an addiction to know that their attorney general is doing everything possible to not only hold them accountable, but to recover resources to help spread them out into the community to help those who are in treatment and battling addiction.
Thank you, sir. Delegate Mayors, your response.
Well, I'm glad you mentioned the opioid epidemic, but it's clearly another disaster of why he's failed at his job. You have nine times the number of people have died so far in the city of Richmond from fentanyl overdoses than gun violence, nine times. You've seen a flood of illegal narcotics and fentanyl that is crossing our border right now. You have states that are literally crying for help. You see deaths of despair and addiction that is skyrocketing right now. But that's not a record to be proud of. You know, in 2017, he had a settlement with Abbott's Lab. What did he do with that money? It should have gone to women's shelters. business. Saying the Northern Virginia Chamber of Commerce refused to endorse you is not being pro-business. Having the NFIB endorse me, I'm the pro-business candidate, because I'm going to realize that right now, the thing that aggravates companies so much are these new regulations that come out of Washington and Richmond and strangle the life out of these small business entrepreneurs. Big companies can afford these regulations. They can hire the accountants and the lawyers to get around them. And so small business owners are the first to get there in the morning and the last to leave at night. They're the ones right now that don't feel like anybody has their back. They sure as heck don't feel like this attorney general or this current governor has their back. I can tell you that right now.
Attorney General Heron, you have 30 seconds.
I have led the charge on the state's response to the opioid epidemic and done it in a multifaceted way, breaking up major narcotics traffickers, doing almost 150 cases of fentanyl and heroin, taking 750 pounds off the street, but I've also held those companies accountable. Virginia will stand to get over $500 million over a period of years because of that work, and the majority of that is going to go back into the communities for local services to help with treatment and prevention, and I'm very proud of that work.
Thank you, sir. Okay, our next question is going to come from Siobhan McFadden, General Director towards Delegate Yarns.
Delegate Yarns, within 3 years, retail sales of marijuana will be legal in Virginia. As Attorney General, what do you see as your office's role in balancing the critical issues of public health, equitable economic opportunity, and public safety?
This is a great example of the fact that the legislature, I tell people all the time, I don't vote on ideas, I vote on bills. The bill that passed the General Assembly said, listen, anything up to an ounce, no fine. Anything up to a pound of marijuana, which anybody been a prosecutor will tell you that's a good amount of weed, is just a small civil fine. And anything above that is possession with intent to distribute. Well, you can't sell marijuana and get a license for the year 2024, but you can possess it. So legally you can't sell it, but what does this mean for the street dealer? They get a 2-year head start. And so it's a completely unworkable bill. However, my job as Attorney General is to call balls and strikes. I'm not going to supersede the judgment of the General Assembly and the governor that passed that bill and signed in the law. So I'm going to defend it in the court. Now, I do think this. I think they need to go back and make sure and add additional provisions of protection to make sure that it doesn't end up in the hands of minors. Because right now what we've seen is obviously an explosion of marijuana use on a very, very upward trend among young people that are minors. But that's an unworkable bill. I hope they revisit it and make it better. But I voted against the bill because, like I said, I don't vote on ideas. I vote on legislation. Will I defend it? Yes, because I'm not going to supersede the judgment of the General Assembly. That's a very, very different standard than Mark Carey, who sees everything through the realms of politics and left-wing ideology. I mean, this is a man who turned down federal grant money to prosecute gun crimes from the federal government because it did not want to meet the requirement that said if you're an illegal immigrant that uses a gun in the commission of a felony, you need to be reported to ICE. Well, he turned down money to prosecute gun crimes because it did not fit his left-wing ideological worldview. I can tell you right now, as Attorney General, I'm going to accept that money, I'm going to prosecute those violent criminals, I'm going to get them off the street, and I'm not going to care about whether they're actually going to be reported to any federal agency, because I'm going to take the money and I'm going to use it.
Very good, thank you. General Harry, you have 2 minutes.
All right, well, first of all, none of that was true. That was Donald Trump illegally withholding money from the state. I sued him, and we won. Now, on the question of marijuana, look, I helped lead the effort to reform our marijuana laws. And I did that because I saw that Virginia was needlessly criminalizing tens of thousands of Virginians. And the weight of that system was falling disproportionately on people of color. And it was the number one on-ramp into the criminal justice system for black Virginians, and it needed to change. And so I led that effort, and legalizing it was the right thing to do. Jason fought it. He was opposed to that. He was opposed to legalizing possession of small amounts of marijuana for adults. And, you know, back when he was a junior prosecutor for a couple years, a lot of the crimes that he led, you know, if it wasn't busting people for a broken taillight, it was putting him in jail for possession of small amounts of marijuana. So we've made a lot of progress in reforming that. We still have work to do. And it's really important that as we move forward, we make sure that small businesses have an opportunity to participate. We need to make sure that revenues go into those communities that have been hardest hit by the war on drugs. And we need to make sure that black businesses have an opportunity to participate in those as well. And that's what I've been doing as Attorney General, to make sure that those opportunities are available.
within your office, and how will you seek to reduce the impact of unconscious bias in how your office enforces the law?
So we are at a moment where we need to do everything we can to expand diversity and inclusion, which we're doing in our office. We have a very diverse staff that is comprised of world-class lawyers and professional staff. But it's also important to make sure that we're leading on laws that reflect the diversity of our state. And the marijuana reform that we just talked about was a big part of that, because the weight of criminalizing marijuana was falling disproportionately on black and brown Virginians, and that needed to change. And something else that needs to change is the is perpetuating the lost cause propaganda in our public spaces. I have worked tirelessly and gone to court and won time and again to remove these symbols of Confederate propaganda from our public places, winning an important case to take the Confederate flag off of license plates, winning an important case to make sure that the statue of Robert E. Lee on a very prominent public place in Richmond comes down. Jason was opposed to the statue coming down and thinks that those symbols should stay up. He even voted against a law that would allow local communities to make decisions on those, like the one right here in the courthouse in Leesburg. Now, how do you tell a black man or a black woman you're going to get a fair hearing inside this room when the courthouse is literally physically blocked by a monument that to a system that would have enslaved and has enslaved millions? You can't. And that's why it's important for us to be looking at all of the laws that we have to make sure that we are doing everything we can to promote the diversity and inclusiveness that reflects the Virginia of today.
Thank you, sir. That'll give me your response. One way to reflect the diversity of Virginia is by electing me. I'd be the first Hispanic ever elected to any statewide office in Virginia history. I'd be the first child of an immigrant ever elected as Attorney General, the first child of an immigrant in 225 years. So as I noted before, anyone that has come to this country, they know this is a remarkable nation. And so, as I love talking to what I call our new Virginian family, my favorite thing to do as a Democrat law enforcement officer in that county, whether it's the chief of police or the sheriff, requests that I come in and I prosecute that case. I mentioned before the case in Fairfax County, where a five-year-old girl was raped and molested over the course of a year. The individual was eligible for life without parole. The prosecutor in that case, Descano, who's endorsed my opponent, decided over the objection of the victims that he was instead going to reduce some of the charges to 17 years, which means this individual will be eligible for geriatric parole in 10 years. That is sickening. You have the Commonwealth's attorney here in this county who has said domestic violence cases need a social response, not a criminal response. Well, I've held the hands of those who are the victims of domestic violence. People who have been the victim of a violent crime in that situation, they always want two things. They're desperate for justice. They're also desperate not to be forgotten. You have some Commonwealth's attorneys up here that have forgotten their victims. So that would be one of my top priorities. If you're not willing to do your own job, well, let me do it for you. Let me hold these scumbags accountable. Let me go after these rapists and these sick child molesters. Because if you're not willing to do your job, I'm going to do your job. And right now, they're not doing theirs. I'll tell you that right now. And there's going to be a big change after November 7th.
Thank you, sir. Attorney General Herron, your response.
We have a gun violence problem in this country and in our Commonwealth. And I have talked with families who felt the pain of gun violence. I've gone to vigils to help honor the memory of those who have been lost by gun violence. Sometimes it is because of a mass shooting. Sometimes it is the everyday gun violence that we see in communities that don't get the attention that the mass shootings do. But the pain is still there. And we need to do everything we can to address gun violence. We have finally started to get some new laws to begin to address it. We've got we reinstated one gun a month. We've gotten a red flag law so that when someone is in crisis and is an imminent threat to themselves or others, they can be separated from their firearms. And we've gotten expanded background checks passed. Jason has voted against every single one of them. He doesn't agree with them. He says he won't enforce them. And we need someone who will continue to build on that progress. There are stronger laws that we can pass. We can strengthen the background checks even more. We can have an assault weapons ban. But if Jason had his way, he would undo and reinstate the gun show loophole so people could buy guns without background checks. He would have more guns everywhere. And that is not how we are going to get our way out of this gun violence problem or crisis that we have. And it's not just about new laws, although that's important. It is also about funding for gun violence prevention and intervention. I know these work and they're successful because we've done them. We had funding for 9 months for one program in Richmond. It reduced homicides 50%, violent crime 30%, and increased tips to the tip line tripled. Those types of efforts can help make our communities safer. That's what I've done, and those are the kinds of initiatives that I would bring forward next year.
Thank you, General Herron. Governor Garris, you have 30 seconds.
Mark Herron's lodge in Chicago and Washington, D.C. should be the safest cities in the country because they have all the gun control laws that he's advocated. The reality is I actually support the policies of lower gun violence, truth in sentencing, parole abolition. You get the violent criminals off the streets, but not back on the street, victimizing more Virginians. That's the proven track record that works, not left-wing rhetoric that Mark Herron is using.
the anti-abortion law out of Texas. I work with a group of other attorneys general in court with the Justice Department to block that law. And we're doing everything we can to help protect a woman's right to choose here in Virginia. We're in the Supreme Court right now trying to protect a woman's right to choose because of a law coming out of an abortion ban coming out of Mississippi. There's another one out of South Carolina that I'm working on to protect a woman's right to choose. It's in the Federal Appeals Court in Richmond. These are the kinds of cases that require cooperation, just like blocking Trump's Muslim ban. You know, we work together to make sure that Virginians were protected, that their rights were guaranteed, and that's the kind of attorney general I'll be. But Jason Miarich would do the opposite. He would go to court to take health care away from me because he's opposed to the Affordable Care Act with its protections for pre-existing conditions. He would go to court to strike down gun safety laws. He would go to court to overturn Roe versus Wade. We can't have an attorney general who is wildly out of step with where Virginians are on issues that matter most to them, their safety, their health care, and the right to be treated equally.
Thank you, sir. Loudoun, your response.
You know, Attorney General Herring, you can't claim you're pro-woman and then be silent in the case of Gregory Joyner. Gregory Joyner abducted, raped, and murdered a 15-year-old girl, Sarah Davison. He was given life without the possibility of parole. They announced in November of 2020 he was getting released. He's still in his 40s. He didn't actually hit the streets until April of 2021. You had 5 months to say something. You had 5 months to do something. You did nothing. To the best of our knowledge, you didn't even bother to write a letter to the parole board. So you can claim you're pro-woman. It's not being pro-woman when you stand by and you stay silent while somebody that raped and murdered a 15-year-old girl is getting out back on the streets while he's still in his 40s. It was public information in November. The Commonwealth's attorney in Lynchburg, who I met with, was begging for help, begging for attention on this horrific, horrific case. You absolutely did nothing. You have certainly tweeted out and bragged that you have turned your office into, quote, a progressive powerhouse. Well, I can tell you on behalf of the victims, so many people right now that feel like nobody has their back and they're being ignored. I want to thank the Attorney General's office zeroed in on the rights of the victims and give them a voice. Because right now they're voiceless. There's no check and balance in Richmond. Right now, this is what a failed record as an Attorney General looks like. And I'm going to change course as soon as I take office.
Very good. Attorney General, you have 30 seconds to respond.
Well, once again, Jason is trying to blame me for decisions I didn't make. He knows that I don't make those decisions. It's with the parole board. And he's been called out time and again by independent fact checkers and reporters for getting the facts wrong and misleading voters. And the truth is, I work with victims every single day in our office, and I care deeply about them and want to help and support them as much as possible, which is one reason why I eliminated the backlog of untested rape kits in this state that has meant so much to survivors of sexual violence, because they know their attorney general is standing with them.
Thank you so much, Attorney General. All right, the next question will come from Stacey Metcalf, and please direct that towards Delegate Miarich first.
Delegate Miarich, both of you gentlemen have enjoyed distinguished careers in the law and public service. Tell us one thing you admire about the record or achievement of your opponent.
Listen, I admire anyone who makes the sacrifices of public service, as Attorney General Herring has. I know the toll that it makes on family. Three died.
So what comes to mind is a vote that Jason cast in support of one of my initiatives, and I'll get into detail about it. You know, I talked earlier about the opioid epidemic. I have sat in recovery meetings so that I could learn more about how an addiction can happen, how easily it can happen, how it can happen to anyone. I've talked with families who've lost loved ones about the pain of having an empty seat at the kitchen table, an empty bedroom upstairs, children who've lost parents. And when I first got involved in that work, it seemed like nobody was listening. But I listened to those who've lost loved ones, and I made a commitment that I would do everything I could to make sure that Virginia families don't feel that same kind of pain. Now, I talked about our effort to hold pharmaceutical companies accountable. That work should result in probably over $500 million coming to Virginia over a period of years to help support those who have been hurt by the opioid crisis. And I brought forward legislation to create an opioid abatement authority comprised mostly of people who are on the front lines of this, and to make sure that as much money as possible would be directed to those who need it most in communities around the state. You know, Jason, you could have said, well, this is Mark Herring's initiative, we're running against each other, I'm not gonna vote for that, or, you know, but he didn't. He voted for it. And I wanna thank you for setting partisanship aside, and in that case, and taking an important vote, even though it was one of my initiatives, that will do so much good for people who are battling addiction in Virginia.
Thank you, sir. Delegate Menarche, you have 30 seconds.
No, I appreciate that, and I have tried to reach across the aisle, and at times find common ground. I think anybody that knows my service to the General Assembly, I think, I hope the craziness in Washington gets stuck in traffic and never hits Richmond. Because you won't see crazy partisan firebombs coming out of
says he won't enforce it. He's still, in 2021, shockingly anti-LGBTQ and won't support protections from discrimination. You know, on issue after issue, he is out of step with where Virginians are, and it is going to fall to the Attorney General on all of these issues to be saying in court where Virginia stands and how to fight in a way, how to fight in court in a way that protects Virginians and expands and protects our rights. And that is the kind of Attorney General I've been, someone who has shown, my record shows, I will always fight for a Virginia that is safer, more prosperous, and more inclusive. And that is the stark contrast between us and the choice that is in front of voters. And that is why I'm asking that we continue to build on the progress we've been making, keep Virginia moving forward. And that's why I'm asking for your continued trust and your vote on or before November 2nd. Thank you all so much for having me.
Thank you, Attorney General Mark Herring. Ladies and gentlemen, can I ask you to please join me in thanking Attorney General Mark Herring, Delegate Jason Biaris, for joining us. Our debate. Thank you for joining us, and please have a great business day.
Thank you. I had one quick clarification question I was hoping to ask him, and the other, like he mentioned the independent fact checkers on the parole board stuff. Did you happen to, by any chance, have any, if you have any, I'll look for them, but if you have any quick and easy links? Yeah, fact checkers that, you know, say he doesn't have anything.
It was the Virginia public media article, the VPM article, when the Winter Fact did the fact check, and then RTD also wrote an article on it, agreeing that like Mark as Attorney General doesn't have like that sort of.
So there's a VPM and an RTD.
Exactly. Okay. I can send you the actual.
If you have them real easy, I would happily take them. If you have to go looking for them, I can do that the same.
Actually, I think they're both in the.
You might have already sent it to me?
When I sent you the brief, the memo before you did your profile with Gordon.
Gotcha. Yeah. Well, let's do it this way. I'll look for them, and if I have a problem finding them, then I'll come back to you.
Do you need a comment for him, like post-debate comment?